BBC Two examines the contrasting fortunes of London band Bush.
Oh, let's go across to the pub.
You know, I'm like anyone, you know. I was like working to pay my rent, working to eat, to live. And I had a dream of being in a band because that's what I wanted to do, that's what I believed in. And it came good.
We couldn't believe what was going on, you know, from Harsden rehearsal rooms to world tours is quite a leap.
This man is an international superstar. He's British, but you've probably never heard of him. His name is Gavin Rossdale, and his band Bush have sold twice as many records in America as Oasis. But there's one thing Britain's biggest rock exports want and still haven't got: recognition at home.
This is Robert Elms, GLR 94.9 FM, London's finest. And it's a London band, I'm glad to say, who are down in the basement as we speak. A London band who must be fed up with being told that they're much bigger in America than they are here. So we're about to rectify all that, aren't we, Gavin?
Is it nice to be home?
It's brilliant to be home. I love it.
You looking forward to playing London?
Yeah, it's like kind of homecoming. Good.
Well, don't forget, I can see your every move.
Ah.
I have cameras trained upon you.
Excellent.
So all gesticulation will be noted and held against you.
Right.
Just stop it.
I can see you too.
Come on, there must be one more to go. What we got?
We got a song off of our first record, 16 Stone. And,
you mean you've got records and everything, isn't it?
Yeah. Not just photographs. And this is a song called Machine It.
Sorry.
Wrong song.
Wrong bag.
And then it took longer to run from the...
We got reserved.
Yes. No, they can't reserve seats, so we have to get on. No.
We've done it all such a weird way. We've done it all backwards, you know, the whole thing of, like, blowing up in America first and then other places after that. That... I guess we're sort of just trying to redress the balance all the time.
We've played to more people in America on our last tour than anybody else did. You know, any other artist going out on tour in America, we did more, we played to more people. Those things are really quite big, you know, they're not sort of trivial pop, you know, here today, gone tomorrow things. They're kind of, you know, it's record book stuff.
Bush have a reputation for being one of the hardest working bands in the business. In America, they play the biggest venues the country has to offer. But in Britain, they're back to square one, playing small gigs like the Cambridge Junction.
I've got a label on that, do you?
Vino Rufino, that one.
Yeah.
Chateau Filth.
Chateau. Weird, we just got used to the size, you know, just like doing, you know, arenas are kind of airy and, you know, and then we're sort of leaping onto these kind of stages and We cooked up. 20 minutes into the show, it just heated up and all the moisture came back, and it was just like everyone was just like standing there with like bathroom hands. And that's why I've got blisters everywhere.
Yeah.
Do you want to see my blisters? There's one there. There's some more. I suffer for my art.
I really like Francis Bacon. But these are like studies for human being. I think this is one of his lovers, I think George Dyer. It always seemed to me that he was always about peeling away the layers, and you know, like if you went to get painted by him, you'd be really pissed off because it's not like you don't come out looking like really pretty or something like that. But it's just all about the distortions of the face, and I guess that's how he saw the distortions of people. And I feel like Sister Wendy now, I've got to stop. I'm having a cultural difficulty with like being in a band and having like art on the wall, but it's a really hard one because as soon as you talk about art and music, it's really pretentious, you know, so I always try to totally keep away from it. But it, secretly in my head, if I could do music that that had the same effect, because that's all these pictures have on me, are effects, the same effect and the same level of kind of confrontation.
Tour is helping to promote their new single, Swallowed, which goes straight into the charts at number 7. That means an appearance on TV's biggest music show, Top of the Pops.
So just steam these two so they're just not creases like that. Yeah. And these,
a couple of buttons on them.
Yeah. May the ladies love a couple of buttons.
Yeah, I'll pop these in the stylist when she comes back.
Perfect.
That's
a great name. Oh, right. Food.
Yeah, so what's all this then?
This is from the stylist.
What's all this then?
Right. The hangers. This is all the stylist stuff.
Thanks. Yeah.
There you go.
Perfect. Nice.
Lovely.
Big Barry White trousers.
It's really nice getting them.
It's one for the grand, isn't it? Top of the Pops. It's one she, whenever you speak to your grand, they always come up. Haven't she on Top of the Pulse yet? No, Gran. We're just about to put that one to bed.
Smoking area, cool.
Been in it,
though. Yes. We're going in an asthma attack.
It's such a benchmark for success in England, which is quite ironic, really. So many bands get on it and you never hear of them again. It's a sort of, there's two sides to it, the one-hit wonders, isn't it? And the kind of established, or yeah, the bands that return.
This next band, we told them a bit earlier in the cast team because they're on tonight. So please, let's hear it for Bush, Platinum in America, Led here.
You know, it's so great to like infiltrate the mainstream like that for us. It's such a laugh. We've been going for a few years. We had like a record that went elsewhere, and just never thought that would go on. Really, I never thought we'd do Top of the Pops.
But work isn't over yet. They still have to get to tonight's gig in Nottingham, 130 miles away.
Yeah.
without a doubt, it rips your life apart because you're always away, and it means that if you're constantly moving and you're always traveling hotel rooms and stuff, it doesn't do a lot for, makes you a bit unstable because you have no grounding. There's nothing, there's nowhere, you don't sort of have anywhere to escape to. You just have the next place that you've got to do whatever you've got to do.
Do shit off.
Nice one, thanks a lot.
Is there any of the others coming out?
I think they're probably out. I don't know. I never know where they are.
Cool. Come back to Nottingham in the future.
No, I'll give you a number. Definitely.
There is a sort of product element to it because you're sort of shunted around. I mean, if we were on wheels, it might be easier. Do you know what I mean? Certainly easier for everyone else, and they could just sort of pull us in and do whatever they need to do with us. But it's like the price you're prepared to pay.
This is dinner. Après show din dins.
Après
June 21st, the longest day. Again. Perfect.
This is the vintage. There's not much.
Ooh, lovely.
But we call it home.
I don't want old wine, I want new wine.
Yeah, can't you buy a bloody new one?
A sold-out tour, a hit single, and their album Razorblade Suitcase in the top five. But Gavin Rossdale isn't happy. He wants some recognition from the music press.
We never heard anyone in any review saying this is an English band that sold 12 million albums worldwide. Well done. Good job. Nice one, boys. You never hear that. It's never been said.
Bush, bless him, are quite clearly 3 years adrift, both musically and spiritually, from the dizzy rush of London in February 1997. They provide the critics with some much-needed bloodletting. After all, here's a band who, plagued by accusations of calculated careerism in the UK, and having sold 10 million albums in the US, still remain obsessed with the idea of gaining some sort of critical acceptance on their own soil.
Well, we're not really interested in Bush, and I don't know anything about them, really. And why would I? They're peddling a kind of outmoded form of music. If they'd managed to do what they've done in America, but in Britain first, if they'd gone out and played tons of British clubs and genuinely the British gig-going public had responded to them in an enormously positive way, so therefore, you know, we could sit here and say, well, you know, I could sit here and say, well, personally I don't see it, but there's a ton of people out there that these people speak to and for, then, you know, obviously we would regard that as a serious proposition for NME, because, you know, part of our job is to reflect what people are actually listening to and what actually gets them off.
Of course you want someone who maybe you like, some of the writers that you've read and they've introduced you to other bands. You know, it was the NME and the Melody Maker introduced me to the Pixies, introduced me to Throne Muses, My Bloody Valentine, and it's a lot easier to be slagged off by the Daily Mail or the Times because you can give a toss.
Personally, if I was Bush and I was raking in the millions, I wouldn't give a toss what the enemy said about me one way or the other. Very flattering that people feel that way. One suspects that therefore there's some rather guilty secret hidden there. Maybe they actually ultimately understand that they're not hip and they want to be.
The whole point about someone like Steve Sutherland is that, you know, the only thing that he has to do with music is to sit around and describe it. And, you know, who does he speak for, really? Does he speak for all those people who came to see us in England? Does he speak for all those people who came to see us in Europe? Or does he speak for all the people like us in America? Or does he speak for himself and his editorial staff and his angle? And he needs to create his good guys and his bad guys.
There is a certain English mentality that seems to, you know, don't get too sort of above your station, you know, sort of don't earn too much money. Otherwise we can't own you anymore, you know, you don't belong to us anymore, you belong to them, the Americans. There is a bit of a sort of them and us thing about America. And I suppose I probably was part of it until I went there and was inside it and realised that they they don't hide behind anything in the music industry there. It's blatantly obvious what's going on, you know. Whereas here, there's a kind of, we're still trying to maintain a front of, like, it's art, which is complete rubbish, you know. It's like, it's art until no one wants, buys it, and then it's nothing.
The British leg of the tour over, Bush head for America, where nobody cares where they're from and nothing succeeds like success.
Here they come. Bush storming the Nashville Arena. Thunder 94 wants to put you in the proper place inside, like backstage.
It's pretty bewildering, the speed and the pace at which everything goes. And when your records blow up, and you start to have success, having never had it before.
Bush has that I've never run across, and I've worked with almost every type of band you can imagine, with artists that are household names, is the work ethic that this band has. And I say especially because they're English, because most English bands do not have the type of work ethic Bush has. It's much more of an American work ethic.
This year, Bush will play nearly 100 concerts to over a million people in cities and towns all across America.
K-Rock.
Gavin Rossdale of Bush insured his dog Winston, whose picture appears on the first Bush album and whose barking shows up on the new album, for $4,800,000 through Lloyd's of London.
How cool is that, first off? A bit of a wicked old lead for the little boy. And just when you think that's it, you know, don't be fooled.
Diamond-crusted bruiser collar.
Yeah, can I have a water?
They've got whole diet.
This is all nice and neat. What a bunch of parts.
The tradition has always been for English bands to come over to America. You know, they've done well in NME and well in Melody Maker, and they've sold out at Brixton Academy and Barrowlands and Nottingham Rock City and all that. And then they come over to America thinking they're cool as shit. They do like Chicago, LA, New York. Take a whole lot of bad coke with someone from record company, sit in a toilet, and then he goes, "I'm gonna make you guys are the greatest thing ever." And they carry around their NME covers with them, and then they go home, and then they're like, "Well, how come no one even gives a toss about us?"
It's two strips, you know, there's the East Coast, the West Coast, and everybody for some reason focuses on those two places. They are the really important places from sort of commercial success, because you've got your MTV on the East Coast and your West Coast LA stuff, and you've got all these TV shows, and they're either based on the East or the West Coast, so everyone focuses on that. But then there's this huge part of America
that's got places I've never heard of that you could put England in, and you play there, and there's 15,000 people there, and you go, hang on, the only thing here is like, apparently is potatoes and sheep or something, and 15,000 people will turn up to this sort of second division ice hockey arena, or I don't even know what, you know, there's an ice hockey team you've never heard of, or a basketball team you've never heard of, from a town you've never heard of, and there's 15,000 people there, and they all buy your records.
Find this mind, find mind.
Sometimes it can be a bit numbing, that number of there's just too many people to think about. And sometimes you come round from a sort of a moment in time where you've been concentrating or lost in a certain area of the song, performing it or whatever. You're like, all these people.
Because the upsides are like so stupid and extreme that you just take it as part of it that certain other parts of you might die, like stability. Not that I ever really had that much of it, but I certainly knew where I was going to sleep most nights and stuff. And I think that being away from your friends, you know, it's weird because the saddest part is that your friends, I keep in touch with a few of my friends, but lots of them think I'm too busy to speak, when really I've got loads of dead time when you come in and call people up.
Joe. Hey. Okay.
Think over.
Where are you?
Turn it off in the sunroom.
Oh my god, is it really early in the morning?
So I do use the phone. But people get on with their lives and they're far away. And it's been now about 3 years of constant travelling. So that stuff is difficult.
When they first started travelling around America, everybody ate, slept and lived on one bus. Now they have two state-of-the-art coaches, the ultimate in four-wheel luxury.
What happens is in these buses you get normally like one back lounge. And always what used to happen was, because I'd probably definitely sleep the least, I would live in the back. So I was the only one with a kind of pull-down sort of bed, because I just would like outlast everyone, really.
What do you think? This is known as the... this is my big boudoir now.
They just wanted their own bedrooms. So they found out a way that you get certain buses that have these, they're called staterooms.
Table, pull out table. Cool. It's great. What do you think? Is this the way to live or what?
I mean, now, to be honest, I'd much prefer to stop, go and write some more songs, go and record another record. That's what would be sort of the best feeling to do and what I think of and what I fantasize about. But yet, when you're confronted by someone saying, you know, this is the demand for the band, you can do 78 arenas, you don't go, no, I just want to do 30, or maybe you do, but we haven't done it yet.
What's this like? This goes straight
in. Oh, yeah, to plug that in.
Yeah.
Right, fix him up with that juice.
The world's first flag.
Was it?
That's it, that's the Satisfaction special there.
Frank that thing. The tedium of the long tour is relieved by the arrival of Gavin Rossdale's girlfriend, Gwen Stefani, who fronts the hugely successful Californian band, No Doubt.
No, I don't mind people knowing about Gwen. It's not that I'm ashamed or anything like that or ever was. It just was like, it had such a potential cartoon element to it because she's doing it then, because she started doing it so well. It is really good in some senses because we can talk about stuff, but the other one is that if someone else is on tour as well, you know, trying to synchronize two people's like ridiculous schedules when, like all the others who have girlfriends or Nigel's married or whatever, they can just come out when they've got downtime.
Gavin and Gwen met when her band supported Bush on their last American tour. But what brought them together now drives them apart. She'll soon have to join her own band on the road, leaving Gavin to finish the tour on his own.
The bit where I get excited is when you go up the ramp at the back of the stage and you hear the roar of the crowd. That's when you know that you're kind of going to get it on and you just...
Love and hate, get it wrong.
was there to take your place. No one knows, never will. Mostly me, but mostly you.
So here we are in Memphis, Tennessee, the home of Elvis Presley. Perhaps Elvis will be in here.
Nope, no Elvis.
Cool. Can we get one more with the backup camera?
I'm going outside.
The backup camera.
Even when it's over, it's not quite over. After every show, there are the fans to meet and greet.
I loved the concert, it was great.
Thank you.
Can I hug you before I leave? Yeah, we're leaving like right now.
Oh my god.
Thank you.
Stop. You just made my daughter's
oh, thank
mom.
You. You were so sweet. Okay.
All right, let Carolyn get her sign and we're out of the way.
I'll buy your next CD.
Thank you.
Wonderful. I'll buy it.
Right. A lot of radio stations in all cities, I mean, obviously they play you, but they also sort of help promote your gig and they'll talk about you. But I guess the payback is you get some, you know, they have a competition. They talk about your band all week. They have a competition at the end and they have 50 winners or something, and you go meet them and sign their albums and stuff.
You can win tickets to the show, hang out backstage at an exclusive Thunder 94 party, complete with food and beverages. And while you're rubbing elbows and laminates, we'll be pandering and kissing up to the members of Bush backstage.
You know, it's a weird one. I don't think any of us particularly enjoy doing it or really look forward to doing it as such, but you know, it's fine. I think those kids are fans and you know, they're genuinely pleased to see you, so you know, you do it, you can't deny them that.
I've never felt so much like I was doing what I was meant to be doing as I do now in my life. I don't figure that I've had the most difficult life, and I don't figure that I've had the easiest life. So it's just sort of rolling with it and going with it. It's an English trait, isn't it, really? I mean, I'm half Scottish as well, which I'm perfectly proud of, and maybe that gives me a little bit of the kind of pit bull jaw-like tenacity that has kept me doing this, and you know, I can take a punch, basically. So that's how I'm still standing and still doing this. There are many ways that I could go to an early exit, and I'm just prolonging it a little bit. Of course, there's no guarantee, you know, I still could be out.